Dear students, I am Dr. Daud, and the topic which I will discuss today is nasopharyngeal carcinoma. Nasopharyngeal carcinoma is a squamous cell carcinoma which arises from the epithelial lining of the nasopharynx. It is most common malignancy in the nasopharynx. The other malignancies in the nasopharynx include lymphoma, salivary gland tumors, and sarcomas. Nasopharyngeal carcinoma is more common in Chinese and North African people, and it is more common in male, and the ratio male to female ratio is 3:1. Its incidence rate starts to rise after the second decade of life, and the median age is 50 years. There are three gross types of nasopharyngeal carcinoma: proliferative, ulcerative, and infiltrative, and the most common location is fossa of Rosenmüller. You can recall from the anatomy of the nasopharynx that the fossa of Rosenmüller is a recess which is present behind the opening of the eustachian tube. As you can see in this picture, this is the opening of the eustachian tube, and behind it, this is the region of the fossa of Rosenmüller. This hole is the nasopharynx, this is the soft palate, this is uvula, and below is the laryngopharynx, and this is oropharynx. You can also see in this picture that this is an opening of the eustachian tube, and behind it, this is a recess which is called fossa of Rosenmüller or lateral pharyngeal recess. Here you can see the norma basalis of the skull. This is the area of the nasopharynx behind the posterior coenoids. You can see that this area is closely related to the foramen lacerum, so any tumor of this region can involve the foramen lacerum as well, and also the structures passing through it. Okay, so what is the lymphatic drainage of the nasopharyngeal area? Lateral retropharyngeal lymph nodes, also called nodes of Robier, are the first nodes in the lymphatic drainage of the nasopharynx, and the other nodes which also drain the nasopharynx include the retropharyngeal lymph nodes, parapharyngeal lymph nodes, jugular chain, lymph nodes of the spinal accessory chain, that is the posterior cervical lymph nodes, supraclavicular lymph nodes, and contralateral nodes can also involve. This is the endoscopic view of the nasopharynx. You can see this is the nasopharynx, this is the opening of the eustachian tube, and this is the area of fossa of Rosenmüller. Here you can also see in the CT scan picture, this is an axial section of the nose and the paranasal sinuses and the nasopharynx. Here you can see it is the torus tuberius, it is a swelling which is formed by the cartilaginous part of the eustachian tube near its opening, and behind this is the lateral pharyngeal recess, or you can say it is fossa of Rosenmüller. So what is the etiology of nasopharyngeal carcinoma? One is genetic, and the other is viral, and the third is environmental. It is commonest in Chinese population, and genomic studies have revealed three human leukocyte antigen locus. One is HLA-A2, second is HLA-B46, and the third is HLA-B17, and they are associated with increased risk of nasopharyngeal carcinoma. There are few viruses which are well documented in the etiology of nasopharyngeal carcinoma. One is Epstein-Barr virus. It is well documented viral fingerprints in the tumor cells, and also anti-Epstein-Barr virus serologies with WHO type 2 and type 3 nasopharyngeal carcinoma. The other virus which is present in the etiology of nasopharyngeal carcinoma is human papilloma virus, and it is a possible factor in the type 1 nasopharyngeal carcinoma. Among the environmental causes, the salted fish food contains nitrosamine, which is a carcinogen, and it can lead to nasopharyngeal carcinoma. Vitamin C deficiency in the diet can also lead to the nasopharyngeal carcinoma. The burning of incense. What is incense? Urdu mein you can say it is agarbatti. So the burning of incense and the woods also release polyaromatic hydrocarbons, and which is also a carcinogen. Then alcohol consumption and cigarette smoking, And occupational exposure to dust, smoke, and chemical fumes can also lead to the increased risk of developing of nasopharyngeal carcinoma. There are three types of nasopharyngeal carcinoma. Type 1 is keratinizing squamous cell, which is among 25%. Then type 2 is non-keratinizing squamous cell carcinoma, which is 12%. And type 3 is undifferentiated carcinoma, which is most common, which is 60%. What are the clinical features with which the patient presents to us? About 50% of the patient presents to us with upper neck swelling due to the enlarged cervical lymph nodes. The other symptoms which the patient presents to us are the blood-stained post-nasal discharge, progressive nasal obstruction, and epistaxis. Among the ear symptoms include the hearing loss, otalgia, otorrhea, and tinnitus, and recurrent serous otitis media due to the involvement of the Richardson tube and the blockade of the tube. Ophthalmologic symptoms include diplopia and ophthalmoplegia if there is involvement of the canine nerve 3, 4, and 6. If there can be proptosis if there is orbital invasion, there can be blindness, involvement of the optic nerve. About 25 to 40% of the patient of nasopharyngeal carcinoma present to us with headache, which indicates the skull base erosion, the facial pain, which indicates the involvement of trigeminal nerve, xerophthalmia, which indicates the involvement of the greater superficial petrosal nerve, and jugular foramen syndrome, there is involvement of the 9th, 10th, and 11th cranial nerve due to the lateral retropharyngeal lymph nodes. The other symptoms which the patient can present to us with are weight loss, anorexia, trismus, and a distant metastasis to the bone, lung, and liver. So nasopharyngeal carcinoma can involve, can spread distally into the bone, lung, or liver. This is a summary of the clinical features which the nasopharyngeal carcinoma present to us. If the foramen, lesser and the veil are involved, then patient can present to us with ophthalmoplegia. If there is involvement of the Richardson tube, then the patient will present to us with recurrent serous otitis media. If there is involvement of the nose and the orbit, then patient will present to us with nasal obstruction, epistaxis, and proptosis. If there is a distant metastasis, then it can go inside into the bone, lung, or liver. It can easily go into the cervical lymph nodes, and the patient will present to us with cervical lymph adenopathy. It can easily go into the parapharyngeal space, and the patient can present to us with 9th, 10th, and 11th cranial palsies along with Horner syndrome. And if there is involvement of the pterygoid muscle, then patient will present to us with trismus. And if there is involvement of the retropharyngeal nodes, then patient will present to us with neck pain and stiffness. So there are a lot of symptoms which the patient of nasopharyngeal carcinoma can present to us, and all these symptoms are very important to learn. So how will you diagnose the patient? For diagnosis, clinical evaluation is very important, then the radiological evaluation, laboratory evaluation, and histopathological evaluation. Among the clinical evaluation, you already know that medical history is very important, examination is very important, complete head and neck examination should be done in these patients. Clinical examination of nasopharynx is usually done by the endoscope these days with the help of a 0 degree or 30 degree Hopkins rod endoscope. As you can see, this is endoscopic view of the nasopharynx. You can see this endoscopic view of the nasopharynx. You can easily see a tumor, fleshy tumor inside the nasopharynx. Here you can also see this is a tube orifice, and this is the tumor bulk which is present in the nasopharynx. Here you can also see that the tumor is present inside the nasopharynx. Then the radiological evaluation. It helps us to make correct diagnosis. It helps us to know the extent of disease, to stage the disease. It helps us to determine the target volume of radiotherapy. It also helps us to evaluate the treatment results, and it is also very important for follow-up. CT scan will tell us about the extent of tumor, the neck node involvement, and the skull base erosion, but MRI is superior than CT for superficial and deep nasopharyngeal soft tissue, and also for differentiating tumor from the soft tissue. And also, if you are suspecting any intracranial involvement or involvement of the brain tissue, then obviously we will go for MRI, not for CT. This is a CT scan picture. You can see that the tumor is present inside the nasopharynx. This is the maxillary sinus. This is the inferior turbinate. This is the nasal septum. Here you can see that there is erosion of the skull base, and probably it is going into the cavernous sinus. Here you can also see that the tumor is going into the cavernous sinus. This is an MRI picture. This is a coronal section, and this is atrial section. Then, what is the importance of PET scan? It is useful in the diagnosing recurrent and the residual lesion following radiotherapy, and it is useful to exclude the distant metastasis before major salvage surgery. Should X-ray be done? X-ray can tell us about the lung metastasis, and abdominal ultrasound will tell us about the liver metastasis, and the bone scan will tell us about the metastasis inside the bone. What is the why PET scan is done? PET scan actually tells us about the metabolic activity of the cells. So, as you all know, that the cancer cells have high metabolic rate. So, bright spots can be seen on PET scan in those areas in which the cancer cells are present. Okay, as you can see in this picture. Then the bone scan also tells us about the metabolic activity, and you can see the dark areas which are present in the bone where the metastasis is present. Among the lab evaluation, the CBC and the LFTs and the special diagnostic tests for type 2 and type 3, like IgA antibodies for viral capsid antigen and IgG antibodies for early antigen, and antibody dependent cellular cytotoxicity assay for Epstein-Barr virus. Histopathological evaluation is very important. It is first necessary investigation for nasopharyngeal carcinoma, and ideally it should be carried out in the first visit, so the patient treatment should not be delayed. And the most common sites are roof of the nasopharynx and the fossa of Rosenmüller. And if the patient present to us with a cervical lymph node, then FNAC should be done. What is the TNM staging? T1 is tumor confined to the nasopharynx or extend to the oropharynx or nasal cavity. T2 is tumor with parapharyngeal extension. And if there is invasion of the bony structures or the paranasal sinuses, it is T3. And if there is involvement of the brain, involvement of orbit, cranial nerves, infratemporal fossa or the hypopharynx, then it is T4. In the TNM setting, the N stands for neck nodes. N0 is no evidence of regional lymph node, and N1 is unilateral and N2 is bilateral. Both are above supraclavicular fossa and less than 6 cm in diameter. If the node extends more than 6 cm, then it is N3. And M0 is no evidence of distal mets, and if the distal mets metastasis is present, we say it is M1. How will you stage in nasopharyngeal carcinoma? Stage 1 includes the T1, N0, M0. Stage 2 includes the T2, N1, M0. Stage 3 includes the T3 or N2, M0. And stage 4 includes the T4 or N3 or M1. This is a flow sheet for the evaluation of the nasopharyngeal carcinoma. If there is after history and examination, you see that there is obvious tumor, then you should go for biopsy, and if the NPC is proven, you will go for treatment. If the diagnosis is uncertain, then you can go for repeat biopsy. If the diagnosis is not nasopharyngeal carcinoma, then you should start the other treatment. If there is normal looking nasopharynx and the clinical suspicion is high of nasopharyngeal carcinoma, then you should go for biopsy. And if the clinically not suspicious, then you should ask the patient to come again for follow-up examination. And on FNAC, if there is squamous cell carcinoma or undifferentiated carcinoma, then biopsy of the nasopharynx should be done. And if there are other diagnoses, then you should start treatment for other nasopharyngeal malignancies. Okay, what is the treatment? The management of NPC is unique. Why? Because the tumor is in a relatively inaccessible location and tumor is extremely radiosensitive. So the treatment modalities include the radiotherapy. It is the modality of choice. Then chemotherapy or the combination with the radiotherapy in advanced disease, and surgery is only done in those cases in which we need just salvage. Okay, and if there is regional failure of radiotherapy. What are the modes of radiotherapy used? First is teletherapy or external beam radiotherapy. If in it there is beams are projected to the target area through the skin. What is brachytherapy? It uses the radioactive material which are placed in close contact with the tumor tissue. There are two types of brachytherapy: interstitial and intracavitary. Interstitial include the radioactive source inserted into the tumor tissue, and intracavitary include the radioactive source placed inside the catheter or molds and then inserted into the nasopharynx. The other modes of radiotherapy used these days are the IMRT. IMRT is intensity modulated radiation therapy. It is recent development in delivery of the radiotherapy where maximum dose can be delivered to the tumor, but important structures, normal structures, can be saved. The other is stereotactic radiosurgery, in which the gamma knife is used to precisely remove the tumor. External beam radiotherapy is the most commonly delivered by opposed lateral fields to encompass to the primary tumor and upper neck. The treatment field has to cover the nasopharynx, the parapharyngeal space, oropharynx, skull base, sphenoid, sinus, posterior ethmoid, posterior half of the maxillary sinus. And the bilateral cervical node irradiation is also mandatory, even if the patient has node negative neck. Here you can see the tumor volume contoured by a clinician for IMRT, and the inner volume is a gross tumor and the outer volume is biological margin added to cover the potential site of spread and microscopic disease. Okay, what is the quantity of radiotherapy rays which should be used? 65 to 70 gray for primary site, 65 to 70 gray for positive lymph nodes, and 50 to 60 gray for negative lymph nodes. It should be delivered in single fraction daily, 5 days per week without interruption. And proper shielding of all critical structures are important to save the normal tissues. Then chemotherapy is believed to act as a radio sensitizer. Okay. And usually the cisplatin and 5-fluorouracil is widely used. What are the complications of chemotherapy? Chemotherapy can cause a lot of complications like bone marrow suppression, sensing or hearing loss, renal impairment, hair loss, weight loss, and nausea and vomiting. Follow-up is very important. Close monitoring of the progress during or after the treatment is very important. Follow-up endoscopy at 6 to 8 weeks and imaging at 10 to 12 weeks are mandatory after radiotherapy or chemoradiotherapy. After the primary treatment, patient should be seen 2 monthly for the first year, 3 monthly for the second and third year, and 6 monthly thereafter. For the lifelong follow-up is needed in these cases. Okay, what will you do if there is recurrence? Recurrence at the primary site can be treated by surgery or re-irradiation. Brachytherapy is preferred in these cases, and the cervical node recurrences are best treated by surgery. Due to the deep location of nasopharynx and the anatomic proximity to the critical structures, radical surgery is typically not used in the nasopharynx. But surgery is limited to taking biopsy. Then neck dissections for persistently enlarged lymph nodes and nasopharyngectomy in persistent or recurrent disease. What are the different approaches of the nasopharyngectomies? These approaches are not very important for you people, but just to give you a look like anterior approaches, inferior approaches, and lateral approaches. Among the anterior approaches include the lateral rhinotomy, transnasal, transmaxillary, and the mid-facial degloving approach and maxillary swing approach. Among the inferior approaches include the transpalatal approach and the mandibular swing approach. And the lateral approach is through the infratemporal fossa. Surgical salvage is usually done for neck dissection. If the neck node persists in the absence of distant metastasis, radical neck dissection should be performed. What is the prognosis of nasopharyngeal carcinoma in stage 1? The prognosis, the 5-year survival rate is 80-90%. In stage 2, it drops to 70-80%. In stage 3, it drops further to 40-60%. And in stage 4, a very poor prognosis, just 20-40% can survive after 5 years. And in stage 4C, the median survival is only 6 months for disseminated disease. So, nasopharyngeal carcinoma is a curable tumor in early stage, especially by radiotherapy, because it is a very radiosensitive tumor. And the surgery is usually not done in these cases. Why? Because the nasopharynx, so many critical structures are present around the nasopharynx, so surgery is usually not possible. Okay. So, what are the prognostic factors? If the TNM staging is high, then it is a poor prognostic factor. If Epstein-Barr virus is present, it is also a poor prognostic factor. Pathologic type, old age, cranium, multiple cranial palsies, and the fixity of nodes is also a poor prognostic factor. What are the complications of radiotherapy? Xerostomia, oropharyngeal mucositis, alopecia, otitis media with effusion, otitis externa, rhinosinusitis, trismus, neck stiffness, dysphagia, and sensory neural deafness. All these are complications of radiotherapy that can occur while treating the nasopharyngeal carcinoma. So this is all about nasopharyngeal carcinoma. Thank you.